Hold on, this is supposed to be a celebration.
If I had to describe Bishop in one word, it would be genuine.
Goat, G-O-A-T.
Excellence.
Dynamic.
Trustworthy.
Illustrative.
Methodical.
Legendary.
I would describe Bishop's leadership as really being God-centered. He really thrives when he hears the voice of God.
Loving.
The example.
Exceptional.
Life-changing.
Observant.
Oh, innovative.
Proof.
I want to wish Bishop and Elder a happy 32nd pastoral anniversary. They have accomplished so much in 32 years. When you have leaders who model integrity, good character, as well as exceptional leadership and stewardship, and genuine concern and care for families and individuals, it inspires you to want to be better. It inspires you to want to do more, and that's what they've done for me and countless others. Their legacy spans generations because they have impacted so many lives. There across our fellowship, within the community, around the world, there is someone who can say that Bishop and Elder made a difference in their life, whether it be through a kind gesture, the ministry of the word, or a change of life moment. They embody what we believe, that church is supposed to change lives. And over the course of their 32 years, they, without question, have made a mark that cannot be erased.
One of the most memorable moments for me with Bishop being my pastor, I remember the two of us were riding in the car, and if my memory serves me, we were riding down Cedar Road, and I was asking him, you know, how do you know that's God saying something to you? Like, how do I know if it's my flesh or if it's God? You know, just trying to understand hearing God's voice. He was honest, and he said, sometimes, even now, I don't know. And I think that that truly allowed me to adjust how I look at my relationship with God and how I move, because what he also shared is, when it's time, it will be clear. And if you don't feel like it's clear, it's not time.
He probably forgot about this moment, but before I was even on staff, I had just graduated from Norfolk State, and I told him that I was interviewing, and he had gave me a suit. And I didn't have like two or three suits at that time, and he had gave me like this custom, I think it was his same size, but we were like, you know, similar in size, and it fit me like to a T, and I still had that suit to this day. It's dusty with mothball holes in it, but I still got it.
My sister transitioned Christmas Eve, 2010. And I started here at the Mount supposedly that Wednesday. But instead, it was the homegoing of my sister. And Bishop eulogized her, and he preached about her name, Camellia. I will never forget it.
I had to preach one Wednesday night for Bible study, and Bishop was not here. But he called me on the phone, and he told me to breathe, calm my nerves when I pray, and you got this.
When the Mount Unity Choir won the Stella Awards, and to have Elder to go up and receive that award with me, and the next day to have my bishop to come in, my pastor, and we go backstage and do interviews, I will never forget that moment.
Whoa, that was emotional. Now let's get back to the celebration.
We made it one more day, let's celebrate, let's go. 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 celebrate, let's go. Let's celebrate, let's go.
Come on, y'all, 32 years. Come on, let's make some noise. Get up on your feet. Let's have a party on today as we celebrate Bishop and Elder and the First Family. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, yeah. With the Mount Collective here, we are excited this morning. Our dancers, our flags. Let's do this, hey.
Stop me now.
So this is what we say.
Hallelujah.
For this.
Thank you, Jesus. Look, at this time, while y'all are on your feet, can you celebrate our leaders for 32 years? Can you celebrate the baddest bishop in the world? Can you celebrate the baddest elder in the world? And that's all right for me, but can you put your hands together for the baddest first family in the world? I don't know about y'all, but I'm excited to have them as my leaders. I get excited when I think about how good my leaders has been. 32 years, y'all, 32 years. Peacock, we got some giveaways. We got some giveaways. Y'all can have a seat, y'all.
Newport News.
Newport News.
All right, I got one more giveaway, but this giveaway is special. So the question for this giveaway is, where did Bishop attend seminary? Okay, I see you, Jessica. So let me tell you real quick what we about to do. So this gift, if you get it right, first tell me what's the answer. That's the correct answer, Virginia Union. So here's your gift. Now you can say, I'm gonna bless somebody else or keep this for yourself. You gonna bless somebody else. Who you gonna bless? Who you gonna bless? Who want it?
Oh, ain't that sweet.
But, when God say you are faithful over a small thing, he say, I still got something left for you.
Oh, come on, Peacock.
Because when you give it away, he does what? He gives it right back to you.
Oh, honey. Come on, Peacock. You just made up for the HBCU Sunday thing.
So you still get
go ahead, Peacock. Now you can get that one to me if you want to. All right, so look, at this time, we want to do a roll call, y'all. We got everybody in the house. I got to say, y'all look good. Y'all in the house today. Can y'all put your hands together for yourselves? Y'all look good. Mount Penn, where you at? The Mount at the Peninsula, make some noise. The Mount at Elizabeth City, make some noise. The Mount at Charlotte, make some noise. The Mount at Virginia Beach, make some noise. Y'all in here. The Mount at Suffolk, make some noise. The Mount at Western Branch, make some noise. The Mount at Portsmouth, also known as TMP, make some noise. The Mount Virtual, make some noise. I know y'all in the house. If you're online, drop some hearts, drop some hearts. And ladies and gentlemen, can you make some noise for where we are? For the Mount at Chesapeake. That's right, that's right, that's right. So look, if y'all can take this time, turn your attention to the screen.
After spending some fruitful years in the background, songwriter, arranger, and background vocalist Anthony Brown stepped forward in 2012 with Anthony Brown and Group Therapy. Performances on three of BET's annual Celebration of Gospel specials in 2006, 2007, and 2012 preceded their self-titled 2012 debut, released by Ty Scott Records. In 2015, they returned with Everyday Jesus. It topped Billboard's Gospel Albums chart, while the single Worth reached the top of the Gospel Songs chart. A Long Way From Sunday followed in 2017. It became Brown and the group's second number one full-length. 2019 was the release of Second Wind Ready, and during the global pandemic, the talented team released Stuck in the House, the Pandemic Project. Coming to the stage, Anthony Brown and Group Therapy.
That sounds so good, but somebody make some noise for Jesus up in this house. If you're excited just to be in the house of the Lord, if you're glad you can come to worship at the Mount, I need you to make some noise in this place. Come on, Mount, don't fool me, don't fool me. I need grateful people, grateful people, grateful people. Hallelujah. I am so excited, so honored, so grateful to be here at the Mighty Mount Church. I'm telling y'all, this church has such an awesome reputation. And I was so mad for a long time at my friend Earl Bynum because I ain't never get no invite. But it seemed like God was saving me for the 32nd anniversary of this amazing church. If the Mount is your church, I need you to make some noise for the Mount. Hallelujah. So I'm already feeling some kind of way. I'm feeling real good this morning. I'm feeling real good. Because we're not just honoring 32 years of faithfulness to the Mount, but we're honoring what God has done in the life of his chosen servant in this location. Can y'all help me celebrate Bishop Brown real quick? Help me celebrate him. I said, help me celebrate him. I said, help me celebrate him. Bishop, we honor you. And while y'all clapping on your feet, come on, give it up for Elder Valerie. Give it up for her. I honor you, woman of God. And while you're on your feet, clap for all the rest of the Browns. We got Campus Pastor Browns. We got Executive Lead Assistant Browns. We got Grandkid Browns. All the Browns. Sorry, that was for me because I'm a Brown. And most of y'all should know this by now, all Browns are related. So I don't know where I am on the family tree. But they saved me for the day because I'm a Brown as well. I'm so grateful to be here. I brought Group Therapy. And we're just going to add to the celebration. Is that okay? Y'all mind if we pray first? Hear our humble That's what we want more than anything, is to hear the Lord say, well done. So Mount family, on your 32nd anniversary, that was probably the calmest it's gonna be on this stage. I figured for my first time here, I wanna be invited back. I shouldn't scare y'all half to death on the first song. But I do wanna tell you that it's about to get very, 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 very ignorant for Jesus right now. I'm not telling you you have to turn up, but I'm telling you that somebody on your row is about to turn up. And I need y'all to figure out on who on your row, who that turn up person is. I need you just to go ahead and get yourself set. Do me a favor, Mount Church, throw up your fingers like this. Put your pinky up like this. Good, turn it out like this and make like this. Cool, go ahead and put your thumb through your first two fingers like that. Wonderful, go ahead and turn it all the way out like this. Beautiful, cross them first two fingers like this. Beautiful, and then bring your thumb and your pinky out like this. Okay, what are we talking about? Tell somebody near you, I got that victory, I got it, I got it, I got it, I got it. And I need some turn up people to get up on your feet right now so we can turn up together. Mount Church, everybody clap, 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 clap. Bring my mic up for me. Everybody clap. Everywhere I go, I take my Jesus with me. Everywhere I go, I take my Jesus with me. Everywhere I am, I know he's out there. That's why I say with him. Here we go. I got that.
Why you always laughing when there is no reason to smile?
To smile.
And everybody say,
oh, yeah.
Why do you keep praying? Things ain't changed for you in quite a while.
Wow. But when I think of all the
stuff I had to go through just so I could be here today,
my glory,
it always reminds me,
yeah.
Go ahead and be thankful.
Bring it up on stage. From the blessings on the wayside,
they said I
won't go, but every time you church, turn up, turn up, turn up. I got that, I got that beat. I got that, I got that, I got that, say, I got that beat. I got that, yeah, I got that, I got that.
Put your hands together everywhere I go. I take my Jesus with me everywhere I go. I take my, yep, yep, I take him everywhere. Woo! Yes, sir. Listen, now you understand why I keep my head held high, even on the worst of days. I'm not caught for the night, but joy comes in the morning. Trouble don't last all. Let's go. Please don't let them tell you what you cannot do just because it's never been done. Woo! You just let them watch you do what they cannot do and just tell them, my God won. Say it.
They said I wasn't gonna make it. Try.
Every time you
baby,
I'll take no. No church, turn up, turn up, turn up, turn up. Turn. I got that. Thanks be unto God who giveth me the victory. Thanks be to my God who giveth me the victory. Yeah. Thanks be to my God who giveth me the victory. Thanks be to my God who giveth me the victory. Say, I got that.
Mount Church, we about to turn up.
I hope you're on the right side. I hope you're on the winning side. Everywhere we go, we always do. I got that challenge. What's it called? What's it called? So I hope you're on the right side. I hope you're on the winning side. I hope y'all on the right side. I hope you sat on the winning side. Nicole, all of them is you. That whole side is you. This whole side is you. Javen, Shirley, this whole side is you. That whole side is you. The whole side is you. So when I get to your side, all you gotta do is sing this part that we about to give to you. What you say is, every time you look up, you gon' see me winning. Every time you look up, you gon' see me. Say, every time you look up, you gon' see me. Look up, look up. Let me hear y'all say it, son. Hold up. That was good practice, but it ain't gonna be enough. You gon' have to sing that part, and you gon' have to turn up. Everybody turn up, whole church turn up. Everybody turn up, move something, turn up. Nicole, your side first. Here we go, one, two, one, two, three, say. Every time
you look up, you gon' see me winning. Every time you look up, you gon' see me winning. Every time you look up, you gon' see me winning. Look up.
A little bit louder.
Every time you look up, you gon' see me winning. Every time you look up, you gon' see me winning. Every time you look up, you gon' see me winning. Look up, look up, look up.
Hold up, hold up, hold up, hold up. That was good. Stay right there. I don't know what y'all gon' do, but if you wanna win, it's up to you. This side, turn up. Everybody turn up. Give God some praise in here. Everybody turn up. Everybody turn up. Come. Everybody turn up. One, two. Every time you look up, you gon'
see me winning. Every time you look up, you gon' see me winning. Every time you look up, you gon' see me winning. Look up, look up, look up.
A little bit louder. Let's have a conversation. It's already gonna be hard for y'all, cause Bishop and Elder is over there, but their side turned up on y'all, and I know y'all can do better. Here comes their grace, here comes their mercy, here comes their second chance, here comes their mercy. Come on, whole side turn up, everybody turn up. Hold that turn up, let's go. Every time you look up, you go. Bishop came and helped ya. That was much better. Stay right there. I don't know what y'all gonna do, but if you wanna win, it's up to you. I don't know what y'all gonna do, if you wanna win. Oh, I see Elder Valerie. This side turn up. Everybody turn up. Cold side turn up. Everybody turn up. Turn up, turn up, turn up. Turn up, turn up, turn up. Let's go, let's go. Every time you look up, you go. Let's be honest. Let's have a talk. Bishop took this side. Elder Valerie took this side. And both sides turned up. Both sides turned up. So there's only one way to settle this today. Is if both sides same time. Both sides, same time. Mount! Everybody turn up. Whole church turn up. Both sides turn up. Everybody turn up. Everybody turn up. Come. Everybody turn up. Let's go. Every time, every time, every time, every time.
Every time you look up, you gon' see me.
Shut.
Every time you look up, you gon' see me.
Every time you look up, you go.
Every time you look up, you gon' see me.
Say it.
Every time you look up, you gon' see me.
Look up, look up, look up. Make some noise out there. Make some noise, my church. Yeah. Woo! Just so we clear, that's not just a turn up. It is a prophetic word for the rest of this year, for whoever receives it, that every time they look up, they're gonna see you winning over and over and over again. One of my favorite little Instagram joints right now says, prepare to be sick of me. That's gonna be somebody this year in this room. Every time the enemy turn around, it's gonna be new car, new house, new job, new situation, new promotion, oops, 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 new marriage, new children, oops, oops, oops. Do me a favor, Mount Church, tell your neighbor, say, prepare to be sick of me. Yes, sir, I feel something in the room. I feel it. I can feel it. It feels like expectation in the mount right this morning. Woo! We gotta move on. But here's the thing. Some of y'all got excited, and some of y'all couldn't get excited when I said that. There's a difference in the room. Here's the difference. People who have faith to trust what they don't see yet, don't wait till God does it. They praise God before they even see it coming. I said, prepare to be sick of me. I thank you, God, for whatever you're going to do in the Mount Church, do it at my house too, Jesus. Whatever you do for Bishop and Elder, do it at my house too. I'm sorry, I'm trying to move on, but I feel that thing in my spirit this morning.
Every time you look up, every time you look up, you're gonna see me winning this year. I'm done losing. I'm finished losing. I'm gonna win for the rest of the year. Okay, okay. I'm gonna sing this song. That clock is still counting. I gotta make sure I do my stuff on time so I can come back. You did not create me to worry. You did not create me to fear. But you created me to worship daily. So I'ma leave it all right here. Help me say it.
You did not create me to worry.
I need some worshipers in the room to help us say it.
You did not create me to fear.
But you created me.
But you created me.
Yes,
to
Lord.
Worship daily.
So I'ma leave it.
Jehovah,
I bow before the King.
Yeah, yeah.
No more crying.
No more crying. No more complaining.
I believe your word.
I believe your word is true.
Lord, you promise.
Lord, you promise never to leave me.
Yeah. No. This is what
so
I'm gonna
this
do.
This is what I'm going to do.
Somebody lift your voice and say, I will trust
in.
Yeah. Yes, I will.
You.
Yeah.
I will trust
yeah.
in.
I'll trust in
you. Lord, I will put my trust in.
You say,
you did not create me to worry.
You created me.
You created me
to worship you. Yes, Lord. So I'ma leave it.
So I'ma leave it all right here.
My hands are right.
My hands are raised because I surrender.
Say, your will.
Your will is what's best for me.
I worship you.
Create me to worry. You did not create me to fear. But you created me to worship daily. So I'ma leave it all right here. Everybody say,
I will trust you.
Come on, say it, Mount. I will trust in you. I'll trust in you. I will put
put my trust in you.
Somebody give God a great praise right there.
Hallelujah, I will trust. Y'all put your hands together for Anthony Brown and Group Therapy. Oh my God, he came in here and broke it. Hey, this is a celebration, ain't it? Hey, I'm still stuck on that turn up part. Y'all know I like to dance a little bit. All right there, y'all in worship right now. It's all right, you stay in worship. I'm still in turn up, it's all right. Hey, look, at this time, if you are giving, so y'all know we don't have no specific time to give carved out in the service, but if you would like to give, we have, you could do it online, number one, you could do it online. Then we also have some canisters on the wall. We got some boxes around the wall, and you could place them in the boxes on your way out. That's the way that you could give. Now, if you have something for Bishop, if you have something for Bishop, we got these silver, okay? Okay, all right. We got these silver canisters up here. Y'all know y'all can't move nothing on me. We got these silver canisters up here. If you have anything for Bishop, you could place it in there. I know y'all feel welcome by now, but any first-time guests in here, first-time guests, make some noise. Okay. We got any first-time guests over here? I got a giveaway for a first time. Okay, I see you. I got a giveaway real quick for a first-time guest. I just want to bless you. I see you. Peacock gave away something. I say, y'all, I went in the back. I said, now y'all need to give me something for my side. There you go. Y'all put your hands together for her. You got to celebrate with other people, because what God will do for somebody else, he can do for you. And I'm talking about, I know y'all feel, man, this is celebrate. Y'all having a good time? Make some noise. So look, at this time, can we stand all over the room? Can we stand all over the room and pray? Can we stand all over the room? And y'all can still come and be a blessing unto Bishop. It's time to pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you, first of all, just thanking you for this day. We thank you right now for 32 years. Lord God, we thank you for a faithful 32 years. Lord God, we thank you for the labor that Bishop and the First Family has put in. Lord God, and we ask that you return back everything 100-fold that he has poured out. Lord God, continue to be a blessing to him and the ministry, Lord God. I dare you to, Lord God, I just want you to keep your hands all over the Mount Global Fellowship of Churches. Lord God, I just ask that you just bless this service. Send your anointing to this place. Continue to place your oil right here, God. Lord God, I pray for the site pastors as they get up to speak. Lord God, I'm just asking just to give them a word, Lord God, that you would have them to speak to your people, Lord God. Give them the confidence to stand in this platform boldly and declare what you have given them. Lord God, we thank you right now for everything that you're working behind the scenes. We thank you right now, God. You're worthy, and we bless your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Woo. Let's stay right there just for a few more minutes. Let's stay right there just for a few more minutes. While I'm thinking about his goodness, I might as well use this time. Not only do we want to celebrate Bishop, but I got to give my God some praise while I'm here. He thought I was worth saving, and I know how raggedy I am. I know how many mistakes I made. I know how many times I would look and say, God, why would you still bless me? Hallelujah. We serve such an awesome God, and he is worthy of all our praise. Glory to God. You may be seated if you can. I'm going to be real quick with my assignment today. I want to lift up one verse that I pray will help encourage us and lift us in the room today. One simple verse, Mark chapter 4, verse 29. Mark chapter 4, verse 29. And it says, as soon as the grain is ready, the farmer comes and harvests it with a sickle, for the harvest time has come. I want to use my time today to teach from the thought, I waited for this. I waited for this. You ain't got to like it, but I waited for this.
When my time finally comes, please understand that I waited for this. I know you see me driving and riding and living. Every time you look up, you see me winning. But please understand that I waited for this. It's been a long time when I was praying and believing God, but please understand that your word of declaration, your word of clapback is just no. I waited for this. I waited for this. Today, I want to hopefully encourage those of us who are in the room today believing God for something strategic. We've been waiting on some stuff, and I come to declare that we're a whole lot closer than we ever knew that we were. We're getting so much closer to seeing that thing, and I believe today just four simple things that I want to help lift up out of this text today that I pray will help us as we are preparing to make that move. Four simple things today that I believe we can look in this text and glean some insight from. The first thing that we see is that the farmer in this text emphasizes the importance of the right time. He says, as soon as the grain is ready, the farmer comes and harvests it with the sickle, for the harvest time has come. So please understand that I'm only moving when it's time. Because moving too early can be just as detrimental as moving too late. But as soon as God releases the job, as soon as God releases the opportunity, as soon as it's time to make a turn and it's time for a transition, trust and believe, as soon as the time is ready, I'm getting ready to move. And what I've discovered is that whenever you're waiting, sometimes people who are watching you wait don't understand what's going on. They think you just playing, but no, baby, I'm watching, because as soon as the grain comes up, as soon as God give me the release, as soon as God say it's time, trust and believe, I'm out of there. I'm waiting for the right time so that whenever God is ready to move, that I can move when he wants to move. Not only does the farmer emphasize the importance of the right time, secondly, the farmer emphasizes the importance of the right title. Again, it says, as soon as the grain is ready, the farmer comes. This ain't for everybody. It is a time of harvest, but this is for the ones who spent some time tilling the ground. That's why I'm not worried about you coming after my stuff, because you ain't worked for this. This is 32 years of tilling the ground. This is 32 years of helping people. This is 32 years of sowing in the ministry. This is not a word for everybody. This is for the ones who possess the title of the farmer. And we're not just talking about monetary seeds, so let me help you, because the Bible says those that sow in tears shall reap in joy. So even for those of us who spent some of the last years crying, spent some of the last years praying, spent some of the last years worrying, I'm come to tell you that your harvest is on the way. So not only does the farmer emphasize the importance of the right time, the right title, thirdly, the farmer emphasizes the importance of having the right tool. Again, it says, as soon as the grain is ready, the farmer comes and harvests it with a sickle, for the harvest time has come. Bishop, the reason why you and Elder have been so successful over these last 32 years is because you discovered how to use what God put in your hand. And the sickle is the anointing and the wisdom and the network and the skills and the talent that God is giving you. And the challenge for those of us in the room is, until you learn what your sickle is, until you discover what it is that God has given you to be able to help bring in the harvest, because understand that the farmer doesn't get the harvest without the sickle. The sickle is the instrument that is needed to pull in that degree, to pull in that business, to pull in that job opportunity. At the moment you discover what your sickle is, you become real dangerous, because the sickle is the tool that's needed to help bring in the harvest. And too many of us are stressed out, concerned, worried, trying to figure out, why hasn't my time come yet? Maybe you need to ask God, Lord, what is my sickle? Because maybe the author in the room, you don't even realize it, but the pen is your sickle. And at the moment you start learning how to write that thing out, you're going to be able to harvest everything that you said belongs to you. Because at the moment you discover what your tool is, baby. So not only does the farmer emphasize the importance of having the right time, the right title, the right tool, lastly, the farmer emphasizes to us the importance of having the right temperament. Now, the thing about the sickle is, again, it's a tool that's used to bring in the harvest. But you did not use the sickle standing up. The sickle required that you get low. And in order to use the sickle, sometimes you would have to get on your knees to be able to get what it is that God is calling you to. And at the moment you learn how to use your sickle with the right temperament. Because Bishop, I want to suggest that so many people have spent the last 32 years trying to duplicate your position, trying to duplicate all of this. But if they were smart, Elder, they would have asked you, how can I duplicate your posture? How can I get my spirit right? How can I do what it is? How it is that you're living? Because at the moment you get your temperament right, God said, I'll make you the ruler. Oh God, I'll take you over a few things and make you rule over many. At the moment you discover what your harvest is, what your sickle is, and you possess the right temperament, God said things can happen for you, but the only way up is to go down. At the moment you learn how to get the right temperament, at the moment you learn how to fix your attitude, at the moment you learn how to fix your spirit and get yourself together, God will position you to be able to acquire everything that God has promised you. The Bible says that as soon as the grain is ready, the farmer comes and harvests it with the sickle, for the harvest time has come. God bless you.
My Lord, my Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. What a word. Harvest time has come. It's amazing how God will speak to us. I believe there is succinct messages that will come that will connect to each other. And it's an honor to be with my brothers and sisters as we add to the word. Didn't even know what Minister Robert was preaching, but if we can go to John chapter 12, verse 24. It says, I tell you the truth, unless a kernel of wheat is planted in the soil and dies. Look at God. It says it remains alone, but its death will produce many new kernels, a plentiful harvest of new lives. Can we just be prophetic this morning and just declare two words over our bishop? Would you just declare plentiful harvest? Plentiful harvest. Didn't know what Minister Robert was preaching, but today, September the 18th, begins the week that we will be coming into a new season. Before the week is over, we would have transitioned into fall. Fall has come to be known the harvest season. It is simply titled the harvest season because this is the season to receive a harvest. And as we have come into this place and we've heard a word that's already preceded before us, I believe that what God is doing today prophetically, what if we are gathered in this room at this particular place, at this particular time, because God is giving us a prophetic template at this particular celebration to articulate to our bishop that this is your season of harvest. Now, here is what's interesting, because I want to set the record straight. I know we got a mixed audience online, a mixed audience in the room, but the reality is the majority of us are not getting nervous when we talk about a harvest for our bishop. And we want to clear the room of supporters in this room that will say our bishop doesn't just deserve it, we support it. Isn't it amazing that week in and week out, we have witnessed our man of God stand on this very platform and declare harvest over every one of us. And I believe this moment is our time, hallelujah, that we don't become selfish for ourselves. But is there anybody in here that don't mind taking a break from receiving a harvest word for yourself, but they could declare a harvest for him? I'm going to start us up, and I need us to turn up, because this, since harvest time has come, we've got authority to declare what the harvest is. And the word declares that it's not just going to be an ordinary harvest, Bishop, but it says a plentiful harvest. And so we declare this morning that our bishop is not walking in an ordinary returns, but he's going to receive returns that exceed the necessary, that exceeds the order, that exceeds the limitation. But Bishop, for the remaining of my time, harvest is not even the assignment the Lord told me to celebrate you for. But if I could choose the topic and give you what the assignment is today, and I'm all right with time, God says it's all right to celebrate for the harvest, but you've got to also balance the celebration with what brings the harvest. And so, Bishop, God told me to say that in this moment, we need to celebrate something that we don't always give attention to. As much as we've seen what God has done in your life, 215 Las Gaviotas, 8 sites, we've seen God manifest blessings for you. The scripture is clear. There will never be a harvest if there wasn't a season of planting. And so, Bishop, this is obvious, but what we want to celebrate is the season that wasn't as obvious for you. That before there was a 215 Las Gaviotas Boulevard, that there was a season called 860 where you had to plant a seed into a congregation of just 75 people. And then at 884, see how the claps got faint? At 884, when everybody looked at what you built but didn't realize there was seeds that you had to plant of patience and persistence, when there was ridicule and criticism and people talked about you, for the tears you had to plant, for the pain you had to endure, for the worry at night you had to plant, for the persistence and the faith, and how you had to plant your feet, and having done all the stand, you still had to stand. Mount family, I want you to understand that you don't get this overnight. The harvest only comes when you can have a character that says, Lord, even if they talk about me, I'm gonna take the seeds and still plant love and still plant faith. Is there anybody in the room? I got 1 minute, I'm gonna move on. That will say, I know people want to celebrate the glory, but don't nobody know the story. Because at the end of the day, I didn't just get this overnight. This came from some tears. This harvest came with some fasting. And so, Bishop, the biggest thing that I raised today is the fact that you are a planter. And I want to use that to minister to those who are planters in the room. Here is what's crazy, because the enemy for the remaining of my time has tried to discourage us into thinking that you've been wasting time. But our bishop stands today as a prophetic example of what's in store for planters. If you've received your harvest, you be quiet. But I need some folk in here that know I got a seed. Can we make the devil real mad? I got 50 seconds. And before we get our harvest, can we bless God that I just at least got a seed in the ground? And when the devil tried to get me to stop planting, I will stand boldly and declare I'ma still plant in my children. I'ma still plant in my business. I'ma still plant in my dreams. I'ma still plant in my vision, because the harvest comes to the planters. Come on, don't stop praising. Don't stop celebrating. I want to use my time real quickly to talk from 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 34 through 36. It reads like this: But David persisted. I've been taking care of my father's sheep and goats, he said. When a lion or a bear comes to steal a lamb from the flock, I go after it with a club and rescue the lamb from its mouth. If the animal turns on me, I catch it by the jaw and club it to death. I have done this to both lions, bears, and I'll do it to this pagan Philistine too, for he has defied the armies of the living God. I want to talk this morning from the point, the protector. The protector. Bishop, you've got many great characteristics, but one of the things I admire the most is the ability to be able to protect God's sheep. If you listen to what David says to Saul, he says, I've been protecting the sheep. And in order to be able to be a protector, you got to understand the assignment. You've got to know why God placed you where you are. And if you don't know the assignment, you don't get 100 men to go to City Hall and stand before them. And if you don't know the assignment, you don't become the pastor of the 757. But you got to understand the assignment when you are the protector. And not only do you have to understand the assignment, you've got to be able to listen to the audible. One of the things that I really love is I love football. I love football a lot. Not that I play, but I love it a lot. Not that I play, but I love it a lot. And when I break down the game of football, you know, the receivers get some love, the running back gets some love, but it's always a section that don't really get no shine. And I want to say it's the offensive lineman. I want to tell you that he is versatile. Not only could he be the quarterback, because if I gave relation and I told you that this was a football team, you'd say he's the quarterback. But what I want to tell you is he's an offensive lineman too. That there are some things that he has protected us against that we've never seen. And it's because of his ear. If he was not able to listen to the audible, how would there be 8 locations? If he was not able to listen to the audible, how would he know when it's time to change and God is doing something different? But he's the protector. And when you're the protector, sometimes you do a role. So not only are you the quarterback, but you got to roll up your sleeves and you got to block. And you got to protect what God has given you. And what I've seen you do, Elder, what I've seen you do for 32 years is roll up your sleeves and block. You've listened to the audible. You've understood the assignment. But I want to tell you that there's a third thing. You've got to be able to remain agile. And for those of us who don't know really what agile is, it's to be able to quickly process and understand when you're agile. How do you know where the demon is coming from if you're not agile? How do you begin to process David if you don't know, if you're not agile, if you're not quickly ready to do what God is asking you to do? If you're not agile, you gotta be agile, because in being agile, you're able to make an adjustment. You're able to see what the times are. You're able to see what God is doing. And he's saying, okay, Bishop, do this. Okay, do that, because I'm protecting my sheep. The protector. I'm almost done. I'm not even going to use all my time. Last thing that I believe, and I'm going to spend my time here, is in order to know and have characteristics of a protector, you got to understand the assignment. You got to be able to listen to the audible. You got to be agile so that you can make adjustments. And then you got to know how to assassinate. You got to know how to kill something. Watch what David does. He says, I've been tending to the sheep. This ain't my first time. You think Goliath is my first time? No, I've been protecting my sheep for long, so I'm already ready for the moment. I know how to kill. And I wonder how many things that he has killed for us that we never saw because of what God had in him, because of what he was able to trust God and do and say, I'll be the protector. I'll take cancer for them. I'll run this demon, but I wonder how many spiritual drive-bys that he walked in here on a Sunday and he took out because of the protector. Yeah, we like to say all of his leadership characteristics, but I want to tell you that this man for 32 years, this family for 32 years, they've been playing roles of the protector. They've been killing stuff that you have never even seen in your household. Demons that never made it to you. I wonder who he took cancer for. I wonder, if you're not ready to kill, how do you know what to do when a pandemic hits? And say, pandemic, I done killed lions and bears. Surely I'm not scared of you. I wonder what would have happened if he didn't know how to kill when all the social injustice was happening and our world was in an uproar, you better learn how to assassinate. Bishop, we thank you for the leader that you are. We thank you for the protector. There are times that you have protected me and I didn't even know it. The phone calls where you've given me direction on what to do, I appreciate you, sir. And you are, both of you are, living protectors. I got 33 seconds and I'm gone. I purposely took my iPad out of this because I want us to be able to understand. I was teaching from this iPad for a long time. And then my sister said to me, she says, you need a case. You need a protector. And I'm like, no, I'm good. No, you need a protector because every now and then, if you're not careful, this iPad will drop. And if you don't got a protector up there, you could be in a world of trouble. But here's the thing. The protector, it doesn't fit every case. It doesn't fit every case. I'm out, y'all. I'm out of time. Turn your attentions to the screen, please.
How old is Bishop? Do you know?
Six, 90, 27.
And
what's Bishop?
65 or 8.
69. 69, 60. I think Bishop is at least 70.
What do you think his favorite color is?
Red.
Red?
Black.
Guess.
Green.
Gray.
White.
Purple.
Pink.
I'm gonna guess light blue, like baby blue, because he wears a lot of them.
Blue.
Can you show me Bishop's favorite dance move? Did you know that Bishop had hair?
He never had hair.
God be the glory, praise God. Come on, we can do better than that. Come on and put those blessed hands together, give God some praise in this place. My assignment, I'm coming from the text John 15:2. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, here it is, he prunes it so that it may bear more fruit. For the few minutes I've been allotted, Bishop, I want to speak from the thought, the pruner. The pruner. One of the things that messed me up, Bishop, is because in the process of what finding out which time I was going as the fourth sight, it messed me up because I wanted to get the topics that was going to cause everybody to shout. Because we shout when we talk about planting. I got a seed in the ground. We shout when we talk about we got a harvest coming up. But nobody shouts when we talk about the fact that there's some pruning that has to be done. Y'all ain't going to talk to me. But I wish I had about 800 of y'all in here that understands that in the process of where you are now, there had to be some pruning in your life. Do I have anybody in here that will just rest on your feet and give God some glory for this man of God who every Sunday came in here and he came in here with some methodical ways about him to make sure that he began to prune us? Watch this, Bishop. As I was going through this, I'm trying to take my time because I know I ain't got but 5 minutes. But he left 2 minutes on the clock. I'm going to take those. When you look at this process of pruning, Bishop, it's crazy. Because not only do you have to plant and harvest, but in that process, Bishop, what we've learned is that there has to be some pruning. Because every now and then, y'all, there's going to be some dead stuff that starts to grow. And when that dead stuff starts to grow, you can't get to what God is calling you to. And Bishop, the other day, I was just trying to figure out what I was going to talk about. And I walked outside and a young lady was working in our garden. And as she was working in the garden, y'all, I started to process what God had gave me for this assignment. As she was working, y'all, I said, yo, those plants over there look like they are dead. Can I just pick them up and just throw them in the trash? She said, Pastor, that ain't what you do. She said, when you look at this plant, it looks like it's dead. But she said, I'm not gonna throw it away. She says, I'm gonna prune it and it's gonna look better than it did when I first planted it. Can you look at somebody and tell them, I look better today than I did when I was first planted, because God did some amazing stuff in my life. Do I have anybody in here that'll just declare? In this text, Bishop, there were two things that Jesus was talking about. He was talking about pruning, and watch this. He was talking about cutting back, and he was talking about cutting off. Some of us don't understand that the shears that you use, watch this, y'all, they are very sharp. And the problem with using those shears is that you could cause more damage than good if you don't know how to use them. And what God showed me about Bishop Brown, y'all, is that every Sunday, Bishop would come in here methodically and he would use the word of God like some pruning shears. Y'all do know that the word of God is sharper than a two-edged sword. Y'all do know that Sunday after Sunday, Wednesday after Wednesday, Bishop came up in here and he gave us a word that changed our lives. Can you look at somebody and tell them, you're looking at somebody that ain't been like this all my life. It took some time for me to come in here for God to use some pruning shears to get to me to where I am now. Somebody better raise your hand and declare, if it had not been for Bishop Brown. Bishop, pruning shears can be a detriment if you don't know what to do with them. But God showed me, Bishop, over the last 32 years, you have been methodical in how you use your pruning shears. One of the things that God showed me was that in my life, I'm one of them cats that don't take a whole lot of mess, and I'll throw some stuff away that could have lived. How many of y'all know that sometimes you'll throw some stuff away that could have lived? But what I love about you, Bishop Brown, is you are so methodical that you know when to put some stuff away and you know when to cut some stuff back. When you cut it back, y'all, new life can come. And I can just talk from my own perspective, Bishop, because there were some seasons in my life when I didn't know how to handle stuff, and you took some pruning shears and you began to cut into my life. Can I talk to you about my marriage? Because there was a time, Bishop, when I was getting ready to throw in the towel, I was getting ready to get a divorce, and I sat in front of you, Bishop, and you took your pruning shears out and you said, Sean, Teron, I got to help you with something, because you think it was your wife that caused the problem. But I'm here to tell you, it was something in you that was causing the problem. And you caused me to look in the mirror, and you caused me to look at myself, and you began to snip away some stuff that was causing some dead stuff to rise. But I thank God now that I'm at 32 years of marriage because you used the pruning shears. Do I have any other marriages in here that will raise up on your feet and declare, the God that I serve used my man of God to... You took the pruning shears, Bishop, and you began to prune my life. And I know that there's some more folk in here. There's some folk online that can declare, you pruned some stuff in us that helped us to move forward and begin to live new life. But can I help somebody in here? How many of y'all know that sometimes the second time around is better than the first time? Can somebody raise your hand in the air and declare, I thought I was good at first, but since God cut some stuff away from me, I'm doing better now than I've ever done. Can I get somebody to give God praise because of this man of God who knows how to use some pruning shears? Bishop, I thought about the fact that not only do you prune us, but you couldn't prune us, Bishop, until you were pruned yourself. Years ago, you had to go to Atlanta so that God could take the pruning shears out and begin to prune away from you the stuff that was keeping the mount from going to where it is now. there was some traditionalism, some stuff inside of you that God began to cut away. And because kingdom was birthed in you, now many of us know the kingdom because of what God did in you. But you first had to be pruned. And now we're living in a space, Bishop, where we never would have been living in had it not been for you being pruned. And now I can declare right here, Bishop, that because of you, I'm the pastor that I am today. Elder, I remember I was getting ready to make a very bad mistake. And my wife got on the phone and she called Bishop. And he said, Teron, what's wrong? And I said, Bishop, ain't nothing wrong. Everything good. He said, then why your wife calling me? He said, Teron, what part of what you getting ready to do have you seen me model before you? And Bishop, you've begun to prune away things in me that would have been detrimental to my life. And I believe that I speak for this entire congregation, the Mount Global Fellowship of Churches, if it hadn't been for you being a pruner, none of us would be where we are today. If you believe that, you ought to rise up on your feet and say, God, thank you for giving me a man of God that took some pruning shears and cut away the stuff in my life that would keep me from getting to my destiny. Bishop, you've proven that you're a planner. You've proven that you are a harvester. But we thank God for the times in the background when nobody saw you in the counseling sessions pruning marriages. We thank you for when you grabbed men and you began to prune away baggage that kept them from being the men that they were supposed to be. We thank you for being a man that was able to use the pruning shears of glory, the word of God, in trimming us back so that we could come forth with new life.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, we got it now. Hallelujah. I declare in this atmosphere that my voice is authorized. Today, my assignment is coming from a Hebrews 11:8, and it reads as follows. It was by faith that Abraham obeyed when God called him to leave home and go to another land that God would give him as his inheritance. He went without knowing where he was going. I want to preach from the topic, you're not crazy, you're a pioneer. One of the things, as I begin to study this particular topic, is that a definition of the pioneer is a person or a group that originates or helps open up a new line of thought or activity or a new method or technical development and prepares the way for others to follow. One of the things that we have to acknowledge is that our bishop is a pioneer. I am living evidence that he is a pioneer. As the first woman site pastor, he had the courage to hear God say, it's now time for a woman to stand in this place. Now, I wish I had some woman who understood that it is your time and it is your turn, because we serve under the leadership of a man of God who understands that a woman can carry not only Jesus, but that she can build a church. Can I get a woman in here to be want you to know, because he hears God. Now the word says here that he heard God speak, but he didn't see where he was going. Our bishop had no idea that 32 years ago, God would have him here. But he had an ear to hear what the Lord was saying. And so on this morning, I want to drop into your spirit four things that a pioneer has. Now, one of the first things I want you to know that Abraham at this time was 75 years old. And I want to prophesy over our bishop that you are just beginning. You're just getting started. I declare right now that God is going to re-energize you, that God is going to regulate your mind in ways that is going to begin to astonish you. I want you to begin to understand, Bishop, God is calling you for such a time as this. Now, the first thing that we will see in the life of a pioneer is that there is a prophetic alignment. There are moments in time that God opens up and releases a pioneering anointing. What do I mean by that? There was a time when God said, I want electricity in the earth, and he raised up a Thomas Edison. There was a time when God said, I want an automobile in the earth realm, and he raised up a Henry Ford. And then there was a time when God said, I want my church to begin to move out of religion. I want my church to begin to move and begin to take over territory. I want you to begin to acknowledge that there's seven mountains of culture, and I want you to begin to preach and prophesy over my people until they begin to understand who they were. And so the first thing that we see as God began to call him out and tell him that I've anointed you in this season to begin to prepare my people to take over, that there's an anointing for prophetic alignment. Now, one of the first things that you have to do when you start operating in a pioneer anointing is to ask God to synchronize you with his timing. Now, one of the things about being synchronized in God's timing, that means that he's going to move some people out of your life. When he told Abraham, it's time for you to go, I need you to leave some people behind. That is one of the hardest things that any of us have to do. But God is saying that right now, the moment you say, God, synchronize my life with your timing, there are going to be people that's going to move out of your life. But I want you to know that's a sign that the prophetic alignment is beginning to manifest in your life. Don't allow anybody to make you think that it is wrong for you to move when God has told you to move. Now, the second thing that God showed me, and he's told me to stay to my assignment, is that a pioneer will always prepare paths for others to follow. It is not just about building something. You have to create a system in such a way that others can follow your pattern. Now, when God told Moses to create the temple, he said to him, they serve in a system of worship that is only a copy, a shadow of the real one in heaven. For Moses was getting ready to build the tabernacle, God gave him this warning. Be sure that you make everything according to the pattern I have shown you here on the mountain. I want you to begin to understand that God showed him us. God showed him what was getting ready to manifest in this season, because he's operating from a paradigm of a prophetic pattern. And then the third thing that we see in the life of a pioneer is that they are productive in pain. Pioneers are never celebrated in the beginning. They are often misunderstood. They are called crazy. And the reality is they face constant rejection. But when you operate in a pioneering anointing, there's a mandate on your life that says, it doesn't matter what anybody else is saying, I'm gonna do what God has called me to do. And I wanna celebrate my bishop on this morning, because the reality is, he stood strong. He stood in the face crazy. But I declare over your life right now, Bishop, you are not crazy. God is even giving you the blueprint, not only for this generation and not only for the next generation, but you are even seeing things for KJ's generation. And I prophesy over you right now that what you are doing is allowing the next generation to be prepared to move in the pioneering anointing. We give you glory. Can we just celebrate the pioneering anointing on our bishop?
Isaiah 43, verses 18 through 20. But forget all that. It's nothing compared to what I'm going to do. For I am about to do something so fresh and so new. See, I've already begun. Do you not see it? I will make pathways through the wilderness, and I will create rivers in the dry wastelands. What I love about this text, Bishop, is you will find the Lord, the Redeemer, Redeemer of the universe, speaking to a person who happens to be a prophet, who happens to be a preacher, who happens to be a planner, who happens to be a protector, who happens to be a pruner, who happens to be a pioneer. What I love about it is that he's telling him what he's about to do. He says, I'm about to send an army to Babylon. And he says, what I'm gonna do is, I'm gonna force the Babylonians to return to the ships that they build. And then he started bragging over the fact of the things that he had already done. He had already led the children of Israel through the Red Sea. And then he allowed Pharaoh and his army to come through the path, and all of them drowned. It's almost as if he was bragging over what he already done. But then he says, you know what? He says, it's nothing worse than old testimonies. He says, what I'm about to do, he says, eyes have not seen and ears have not heard, neither have it entered into the hearts of man the things that I have prepared for those that love me. He says, in fact, I'm about to do something new. You see, I've already begun. Can't you see it? He said, I'm gonna make pathways in the wilderness. If I can tag this message, he said, what I would call it, I'll call it a creative evangelist. Oh, I just said it. See, two things I learned, Bishop, when I was at Virginia Union. One of the things that I learned is that anytime you approach a tech, you always got to have a behavioral objective. My behavioral objective is today is to inform you, sir, and not only inform you, but to inspire you. See, being married to one of the greatest wives that is, one of the other things I learned is that you got to give credit to the source. My wife and I was kind of like talking to see what would be a great word. And since all of the site pastors came with the word peak, she came up with a word I'd never heard before. The word that she came up with was Promethean. Yeah, I know you ain't never heard of it. Promethean. Promethean means, it's a Greek word. It's anciently interpreted as a forethinker, a foreseer. It means daringly original, creative, innovative. Now, according to Greek mythology, Prometheus
He was a Greek god who was known for his intelligence. He was known for his brilliance. He was a champion of humankind. He would go into environments. He would go into atmospheres. He would go into hemispheres. And he would take stuff from the gods, the rulers, the leaders, and he would come back and give it to humanity. Well, when she told me that, I thought about you, sir. He put me in a mind of you. I see you go into environments. I see you go into spaces and places and atmospheres and take from them and bring it back and give it to the site pastors. Give it to Pastor Teron. Give it to Elder Deneen. Give it to Pastor Alvin. And then turn around and give it to the fellowship. You would go before God and get godly wisdom, get godly knowledge, get godly insight, get godly understanding, and you will come back to us what you've taken from him, and you will distribute it all through us. What you was doing in that season was, God was using you to not only plant site pastors, you were sending pastors to make pathways in desolate places, cutting rivers through the wilderness so that people can be refreshed, people can be renewed, people can be restored, people can be revived, people can be reminded that there is a God somewhere where people have been burned out, hurt, tired of tradition. You created a place for the second dimension of believers that they can bring their gifts and talents and their soul to the kingdom. Sir, you are an innovator. You are an inspirer. You are a creative evangelist. So today, we celebrate 32 years of pastoral leadership, 32 years of ministry. God has done some extraordinary things to you. But Isaiah reminds us, forget about all of that. It's nothing compared to what he's about to do. Oh, he's about to do something that's gonna shake this world. He's gonna create pathways in desolate places. You will not only have 8 site pastors, but there will be other rivers that flow through this universe. Oh, you are a creative evangelist. Oh, I'm out of time, but I'm also out of the text.
Chapter 2, verses 1 through 6, and it reads, early the following spring, in the month of Nisan, during the 20th year of King Arts' reign, King Arts' reign, I was serving the king his wine. I had never before appeared sad in his presence. So the king asked me, why are you looking so sad? You don't look sick to me. You must be deeply troubled. Then I was terrified, but I replied, long live the king. How can I not be sad? For the city where my ancestors are buried is in ruins, and the gates have been destroyed by fire. The king asked, well, how can I help you? With a prayer to the God of heaven, I replied, if it please the king, and if you are pleased with me, your servant, send me to Judah to rebuild the city where my ancestors are buried. The king, with his queen sitting beside him, asked, how long will you be gone? Then where will you return? After I told him how long I would be gone, the king agreed to my request. So my focus point today on Pastor's anniversary is visionary. And if I had to title this very quick message, I would call it Painting the Perfect Picture. Painting the Perfect Picture. I got to be honest, as we received this assignment, as all the site pastors and I received this assignment to teach today, and we had to come up with a focus point to talk about our bishop on the day, I had a hard time kind of realizing or figuring out a specific focus point that I wanted to talk about, because y'all know, like I know, Bishop got a very big personality. He got a lot of qualities, a lot of traits, a lot of different characteristics that I could choose from. And so I did end up settling it on visionary. And so y'all know me, the first thing I did is I had to take a look at the definition of visionary, and it took me to my first point. And so the definition of a visionary says that a visionary is a person who thinks about or plans the future with imagination or wisdom. And if you read a little further in the story, because of our short time, I don't got time to give y'all the whole story, but if you read a little further in the story, Bishop, after the king agreed to send Nehemiah away, Nehemiah asked him for two quick letters. He said, first, I need a letter of safe passage. You know, I ain't gonna be able to get there, because y'all know back in the day, you couldn't just go from town to town, city to city, territory to territory without a hall pass, or you need a pass to be able to get through wherever you wanted to go. So Nehemiah knew, first thing I need is a hall pass to get over there. Second thing he asked was for a letter, because he needed some material. He knew he was going to need some wood and some timber to be able to build those city walls that God had laid upon his heart. So he knew that he was going to need some things, and he wanted a house. So I guess, I don't know, maybe Nehemiah was a little bougie. He didn't want to just stay in a little manger or whatever. He needed a house. So Nehemiah was already operating and planning with imagination and wisdom. And y'all tell me that ain't like Bishop. Y'all know Bishop. If y'all know Bishop, Bishop is one of the most imaginative leaders I ever known. He always coming up with new ways to take territory for the kingdom. He always trying to define new ways that we can, you know, serve the community, and trying to come up with creative ways for the church to change lives. Bishop is an imaginative leader, and not only is he imaginative, but y'all know Bishop is going to come up with some wisdom. He going to seek some wisdom. Bishop going to see some. He don't really just come up with, I got the family right here. Y'all know he will shoot off the hip sometime a little bit. But y'all know 99% of the time, Bishop is going to seek some wisdom. A lack of knowledge ain't our leader's issue. Bishop is gonna be informed. Bishop is gonna be informed. So the first thing that I want to say, the first thing a visionary does is that he leads or plans with imaginary, with imagination and wisdom. But the second thing a visionary does is he doesn't get distracted by small setbacks and obstacles. A visionary doesn't get set back by small setbacks and obstacles. A benefit of being visionary is the ability to focus on worthy. When you focus your energy on what matters, you do not become distracted by external forces. As a result, you always have your vision and your ultimate goal in mind, and you remind it to others no matter how difficult the situation is. Now, I told y'all a little bit earlier, I don't got time to give y'all the whole story, but in Nehemiah 2:19, Nehemiah people had people who was giving him a little resistance as well. They tell him, you know, you don't got no claim to this area. You don't have no territory. This is not yours. Like, how you think you're going to just come down here and rebuild the city walls? And all Nehemiah did was say, look, man, I already talked to the God. I already had a conversation with God. God got his hand on me. We're going to make this thing happen. And so the people went on ahead and sit and joined in with him, because Nehemiah is a visionary. And visionaries don't get distracted by small setbacks, because here's the thing. Visionaries are always big picture oriented. Visionaries are always big picture oriented. And listen, small setbacks don't keep the big picture from manifesting. Small setbacks don't keep the big picture from manifesting. And then here's the other thing about being, you know, not letting small setbacks. When you're a visionary, you forecast for certain things, right? So bad weather don't get you, because I forecasted for bad weather. People leaving me don't get me, because I forecasted for people leaving my team. You know, small setbacks don't distract our bishop. Bishop, you remember the time when you bought the first church bus, but it messed around, it was too small, and you bought a bus that only kids could ride in. Small setback. You remember that time when we was building 884 and we had the framework up and the storm came through here and knocked the framework down, had the church looking like a pile of toothpicks. Small setback. You remember that time, Bishop, when you went to the doctor for a routine checkup, found out you had cancer. Small setback. Somebody just say small setback. If you're watching online, I dare you to put it in the chat. Just say small setback. Visionaries don't get distracted by small setbacks. So we know the first thing that visionaries do is they use imagination and wisdom. The second thing that visionaries do is they don't get distracted by small setbacks or obstacles. The third thing that visionaries do is they get everybody else on board. Visionaries get everybody else on board. If you look at chapter 3 in Nehemiah, the whole chapter of Nehemiah 3 does nothing but tell us about all the people who helped Nehemiah build a wall. The whole chapter. If you go and look at Nehemiah chapter 3, it does nothing but tell you group after group after group of people who helped Nehemiah build a wall. But here's the thing about visionaries. They don't get everybody on board just by simply telling people what to do. Visionaries get everybody on board by painting the perfect picture of the vision. They paint the perfect picture of the vision. And here's the thing. I want to thank God today for a man who makes the vision clear here. I want us all to thank God today for a man who shares with such clarity and transparency. I want to thank God for today for a man who makes the vision clear, not only for us here at the church, but he makes the vision clear in my own life. Because if my vision clears my own life, my life decisions are better. I become more disciplined because my vision is clear. I make better decisions in life because my vision is clear. I'm back in school right now because my vision is clear. I started my business because my vision is clear. My kids are headed in the right direction because my vision is clear. A visionary gets people on board by painting the perfect picture. So thank you, Bishop and Elder, for being our visionary and for painting the perfect picture. Amen. 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 All right, thank you. If I could get all the site pastors. Can y'all bless God for all the site pastors? They were amazing. They were amazing. Bless God one more time for our leaders, Bishop and Elder. Also, if I can get, Pastor Furby, representing for the Mount at Chesapeake. And then I believe I'm turning it over to Pastor Cooper. We're supposed to be going in the same order, I believe.
All right.
Yes, sir.
Well. Real brief, thank you, Bishop, for allowing us to be here. I get the privilege of standing in proxy on behalf of the Mount at Elizabeth City. Thank you, sir, for trusting me with this assignment and giving me an opportunity to be able to have a training ground where I can grow and the people can grow too. So on behalf of the Mount at Elizabeth City today, we want to sow $1,000. And I myself want to also sow $1,000 into you. So thank you so much.
What do you say? 32 years of ministry, and once again, thank you for what you planted in me. I still remember the day that you made the transfer from my father to plant me here, and boy, did you sow into me. And look at where God has us even to this day. So Bishop, we thank God for you, but we have enough sense to Mount Peninsula. We didn't just sow into Bishop, but we're also sowing into Elder as well. Hallelujah. Because as much as you planted into me, I think the pruner point came from Elder, and I thank God for what you pruned. So God bless you. We love you. Bishop, thank you so much on behalf of all the partners at the Mount at Charlotte. We appreciate you planting us. We appreciate your trust in us, Brandon, myself, and our family. I don't know anybody else that would trust me. No license, none of that stuff, so I appreciate it. I appreciate you, sir. We love you. We thank you for the model that you've been for all of us at the Global Fellowship. And hopefully, you may not be able to take this to the mall, but you can take it somewhere. You may take it somewhere.
This is a check for $5,000 from the Mount Virginia Beach.
Well, Bishop and Elder, we are just so proud of all that God has done through you. And on behalf of the Mount at Weston Branch today, we want to sow on behalf of our building, which is coming, $3,200. And as well, from Chief and I, we're giving $2,000.
Well,
Bishop, I think the psalmist said it best, that every time I looked up, I saw y'all win. So on y'all 32nd pastoral anniversary, I mean, words, I don't even have the word to express my gratitude and appreciation for the modelship that you guys display toward us, for the outpouring of your love and your time. I mean, I wish I had more, but look, on behalf of the Mount Suffolk, my wife and Cutting This Image Ministry, we wanted to sow $7,300 into your pastor's anniversary. And sir, thank you for all that you do. We love y'all.
Over in Spain, she comes back to bar. She sends her love as well to you all. So God bless you from Spain. Happy anniversary.
So Bishop and Elder, of course, y'all know we love you all so much as well, Dr. Keisha and I, the family, and as well our entire TMP family. TMP, y'all make some noise real quick for Bishop and Elder. Thank y'all so much. We love y'all again. Happy anniversary and congratulations once again on 32 years. We love y'all.
You know, in 1990, the number four song was You Can't Touch This. Bishop, I've been known to do some dumb things. And I thought one of the dumbest things I did was convince Elder to allow me to go to Texas to Gateway. If you remember, we all went to the Final Four. And you woke up that Sunday morning asking, where was I? Well, I was working. I was in tutorial at Gateway. You got on the internet, you called me and said, Pastor, I'll be there for the next service. When you got there, I scratched my head because I said, I brought you to a place that has put me out of a job, because screens came down and that pastor preached at every site. But I remember us walking up to A&T Stadium that day and you said, you might not remember this, you said, Ferb, don't worry about it because I love pastors. Chesapeake, will you stand up? All of Chesapeake, will you stand up? Bishop, 32 years, man, you can't touch this. But on behalf of the mothership, Bishop, it's not 1,000. It's not 2,000. It's not 3,000. It's not 4,000. Bishop, I ain't gonna tell him how many thousands it is. But sir, we love you. Elder, we love you. Dr. Keisha, Brother Williams, Pastor LJ, happy 32 years, sir. God bless you all. And you know what? Since you're standing, I know there may have been many of you all who did not have the opportunity to participate early because you thought it was a general offering. But if you have something special for Bishop and Elder and you have not yet had the opportunity to deposit, you can do that at this time. The baskets are here, the buckets are here. And if you don't mind coming, if you haven't already, you can come. We just wanted to provide that opportunity just in case persons did not have the opportunity. Those online, you can take advantage of this. Follow the directions from the screen. It's going to put exactly how you can give towards Bishop and Elder. You can take advantage of this moment. If you haven't had a chance, you can come at this time. Those who are online, just simply take advantage of the directions of our media. You too can make that deposit today. Amen. Might the people of God say amen. Amen. I guess we're ready to receive, ladies and gentlemen, the presiding prelate of the Mount Global Fellowship of Churches and the senior site pastor of the Mount at Chesapeake and his lovely bride, our executive pastor, Bishop K.W. Brown, Elder Valerie K. Brown. Come on, put your hands together and let's receive our pastor.
Amen. Can we bless God one more time? Wow. Now, you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We're not going to be before you long. We know it's, well, that's been a long day. You and had great worship and everything, and it's 11 o'clock, so it's been 2 hours. Y'all remember when y'all used to go to church for 4 hours, so don't even, you know, some of us have just forgotten. First thing we got to do, the most important thing we got to do, thank you all for giving me that privilege. If you're in this room and you don't know the Lord as your personal Lord and Savior, or if you're watching online and you said, man, I've never seen a church have this much fun, be able to celebrate, and you want to make a decision for Christ today, all you've got to do right now, even in the room, if you stand in the room, we're going to still ask you to just text the word accept to 71441. Text the word accept to 71441. If you're online or you're in the room and you desire to rededicate your life to Christ. Now, just y'all see this young man. Isn't this the, is that the, where's Alex? You the new, that's the new employee. I hired you, man, by mistake. Because I didn't know you were from Virginia State. We ain't hiring no more Virginia State folks up in here. We got enough Virginia State folks. He was a media. What was your major? Mass communications, media at Virginia State, and he started volunteering. And I just wanted to share that because by the time he had gotten a job, the director at Virginia State said, you know, we got a new staff person at the church. I said, yeah, who was that? She said, you know, the young man is so mannerable. And she was boosting you up. So Trojan pride and all that. All right, so I don't even know how I get distracted. So if you are desire to rededicate your life to Christ, and you know, Bishop Long used to say this years ago. He said sometimes backsliding is not what we've made it in the church. It's not smoking cigarettes and drinking alcohol. Backsliding is when God might have decided to move, and we were too arrogant to move with God. So there's a distance between us, and you know you're not as close to God as you used to be, and you want to fix that today. All you got to do is text the word restart to 71441. And if you believe this is your church family, that I am your spiritual leader, or any one of these other great men and women of God, got enough sights for all, anybody, all tastes, all flavors. If you believe the Mount Global Fellowship of Churches is where you're supposed to be, all you got to do is text the word mount up to 71441. Amen. Now, you know I'm not going to even begin to call names and thank individuals because I will mess this up. So I'm going to just say thank you to everybody. Now, you will see staff. Today is a mixed emotion day. You'll see staff wearing this white ribbon. This white ribbon is in honor of Trustee William Alexander. You know him as Mr. Bill, who went to be with the Lord this week. We're working out plans for his homecoming, homegoing. The reality is, the number one thing about Mr. Bill is if you ask him to do something, he was gonna say, Bill, don't do that. And then he was gonna go do it. And so staff is wearing this. Can you bless God as well for staff and just anybody that had anything to do with today? Did you have a good time in the Lord today? Amen. All right. Just before we go, I need 10 minutes. And I'm going to ask you, nobody, no, what was the thing? Me and my son used to watch this movie. Nobody move, nobody move, nobody move. Just 10 minutes. Just want to share with you some vision. This is year 32. I am 60 years old. So over half of my life, I have served one church by the grace of God. Now, don't panic, but I do want to read two scriptures for you. The first one is Numbers chapter 8, verse 23. Is that the right scripture? Is that right? Okay. The Lord also instructed Moses. This is the rule the Levites must follow. They must begin serving in the tabernacle at the age of 25, and they must retire at the age of 50. After retirement, they may assist their fellow Levites by serving as guards at the tabernacle, but they may not officiate in the service. This is how you must assign duties to the Levites. Can you all put up my next scripture? 2 Samuel 21, verse 17 says, but Abishai, son of Zeruiah, came to... No, that's... Man, can we back up? Can y'all go back? Or do we only have 17? Can we do 15? Can we do 15? I know I might have given y'all just one. Okay. For those of you that don't know the context of 2 Samuel 21, what's going on is David is fighting now the next generation of Goliaths. And this Goliath has a new sword. Thank you. Oh, they got it up now? Okay, thank you. Once again, the Philistines were at war with Israel, and when David and his men were in the thick of battle, David became weak and exhausted. 16, if we can, or I can read it here. Ishbinibab was a descendant of the giants. His bronze spearhead weighed more than 7 pounds, and he was armed with a new sword. He had cornered David and was about to kill him. Now we can go to verse 17. Thank you all. But Abishai, son of Zeruiah, came to David's rescue. Y'all ought to clap, because I fake getting those names right. Because y'all ain't know him, so you didn't know if I mispronounced him or not. Y'all was sitting there saying, man, that's why he's my bishop. Look at him, he's saying all them words. I'm just a bill. Yes, I was trying to remember all that stuff from Saturday morning. Then David's men declared, you are not going out to battle with us again. Why risk snuffing out the light of Israel? We've got all sites represented here today, specifically Chesapeake site represented here today. For the last year and a half, let me say this, about 10 years ago, Chesapeake went on record to give me the privilege to be the first pastor since Mount Lebanon was birthed in 1902 to be able to name its successor. I am the very first pastor, and I remember that night. In fact, it was a Saturday morning church meeting, and the elders had convened the church. I was actually preaching my auntie's funeral. And that's how I knew this was a different church, when the elders could meet with the church and the pastor was somewhere preaching his auntie's funeral. And they voted that day, based upon years of faithful service, to give me the privilege to name the successor at Chesapeake. That was long before we had any sites or anything. And so for the last year, Elder and I, especially me, have been just studying these two scriptures, because they talk about the Levites' time of service. One of the things that dawned on me was that the Levites didn't really retire, they repositioned. Hear that in the spirit, y'all. And let me just say this. So what I'm going to do today is acknowledge for you who my successor is for the Mount Chesapeake. Now, let me make sure we get it clear. I'm not sick. I'm not dying. Doctor hadn't told me I got 6 months to live. So when y'all see all this stuff that's about to cap off on Facebook, he ain't want the saints to know he got cancer. It's stage 4. It's all over his body. They said, girl, it's gone up to his brain. Now, I know if you go based upon the way I articulate and stuff I do sometimes, that might be a valid, summation. But I'm healthy. I am not saying I'm retiring today. In fact, what I'm saying now is I'm no longer even going to retire. I'm repositioning myself when that time comes. Amen, somebody. But one of the things that was clear is the Levite repositioned himself to become the guard. Read that scripture. So if you don't take out anything else, all this worship that group therapy has led us in with their leader, and all this worship that the Mount Collective has led us in, all this word, can you bless God for these pastors who have just done a tremendous job? Now I need you to go old school, elbow your neighbor and tell them, don't take out no twisted stuff. It's not effective today unless on the way home, drunk driver, I know that y'all gonna say don't speak no stuff, something happens, it's effective today. We don't need 32 people to get no pulpit committee together. We ain't gonna be that church. That ain't our flow. That ain't, and I gotta be careful how I say this because I'm not talking about anybody else's church, but find pulpit committee in the Bible. That's all I'm gonna ask you to do. Bible says when it was time for Moses to roll off, he went and got Joshua, he stood Joshua up, and God declared, the same way I was with Moses, I'm gonna be with Joshua. When you look at Elijah, Elisha, and all of, you know, it's biblical to have succession. So what I am articulating today is that over the last year and a half, and I don't know if we can put the attributes up. Can you bring me my phone? And I'm probably not gonna get all the attributes right. But over the last year and a half, Dr. Chan has been working with me. We created an avatar. Thank you. And the avatar, pastor had to be under 40. My successor had to be under 40. Once again, I don't know why people get 70 and then call somebody to be the pastor when they retire. That's 69. You know, I mean, that's just, you know, I came to the mountain when I was 28 and now I'm 60. I wanted somebody to be able to have that kind of longevity. So it had to be under 40, had to be seminary trained, had to have good credit, had to have a wife that loved the saints and loved the Lord, had to have a good family life, had to have integrity, had to have humility, had to be able to be accountable, had to be able to be loyal. I think that's pretty much all of them. And so what I'm really excited about, it is my pleasure, and I want Chesapeake. Here's what's so amazing. I have literally met with the elders, I've met with staff here, I've met with the deacons, deaconess, and the ministers. I met yesterday with a cross-section of Chesapeake partners that were just a cross-section of people in a cross-section of the fellowship. And then as late as last night really blessed me. Because last night I had the pleasure of meeting virtually with TMP. And I want to thank TMP for the way y'all just broke us down. We had a crying moment last night. So I am acknowledging today that when my season as the pastor of Mount Chesapeake is over and I only become the bishop, I am the bishop. I will then remain as the bishop, as the guardian. I'm proud to acknowledge today that my successor is Pastor L.J. Brown. So if you'll come stand. Jesus. Hallelujah, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now get it straight. Today he is the pastor of TMP. And we talked about this last night, but there will come a day he will be the pastor of the Mount Chesapeake. Now, TMP, we got you. We love you. We working. Just like God spoke for the Mount Chesapeake, he's going to speak for the Mount at Portsmouth. And that's going to come through him. That ain't my pressure now. That's his pressure. And so, but now everybody can stop emailing me. I can stop getting letters from around the world, from preachers, prophets, potentates, expounders of the gospel that have all told me God spoke to them and said they were my successor. Well, God spoke to me and said, that's my successor. Amen. All right, Dr. Keisha, come stand. Now, right now, you're clapping for the First Lady at the Mount Portsmouth. I'm getting ready to bring the First Lady of the Mount Chesapeake up on the stage. But I wanted y'all to see that. Let me just say this, y'all. This was great today. We had a ball today. Thank you for the love. Thank you for everything that the fellowship did to express any kind of gratitude.
when I'm gone, I'm gonna be in heaven. Don't let me be looking over the portals of glory from my big mansion and see no foolishness down here. Don't y'all let no demonic stuff rise up in here saying, no, nah, they ain't, no. Nah. Anybody come saying that they know my heart and my heart was not this, they didn't know my heart. And I want to just bless God for the leaders in this fellowship that 10 years ago gave me the privilege to be able to do this. And I remember when they gave me the privilege, I'm like, oh man, that's a long time. It's like I went to bed, it was 10 years ago, and I woke up, it was today. And so next Sunday, he gonna be at the Mount Portsmouth. I just wanna let y'all know that I'm still the pastor at Mount Chesapeake, amen. And I'm just proud of this young couple. And so please, when that day comes, honor the memory of my service by honoring the memory or the ministry of their service. Amen? All right. All right, y'all ready? We almost there. I'm going to ask the good elder to come up. Amen. So I'm going to decrease. I heard Pastor Teron say something. Y'all, you know I got to mess with somebody. Y'all knew I was always the antagonist in school. Pastor Teron, I heard you say Tasha got that nice color in her hair. And you did. Elder got that nice color in hers, too. Ebony black. Yes, sir. Doing the same thing for me, too, so. We getting ready to go home.
Oh, good morning. Good morning, Mount Lebanon. I feel like y'all been standing forever, and I get on Bishop for this all the time. Y'all sit down. I mean, we going out of here. I know you're ready to go, but look, he always do that. I be like, you say stand up, we ready to go, and then it'll be an hour later, and we still standing. But okay. All right. I want to echo everything Bishop said, and thank you as well for everything you've done for us over the years. But like Bishop, I am going to reposition myself as well. I have been working, y'all. We were beginning to talk about this. I look back over my life, and I have worked every single day, every single year, for 44 years I have been working. 44 years, and 32 of those years have been here at the Mount, and so I am repositioning. And as we celebrate on today, it gives me great pleasure to announce who my successor will be as well. And I know it's no surprise to y'all who my successor is. I've been saying that since the day she walked, since the day she came on board here at Mount Lebanon. She's been here for 7 years. My successor is Dr. Kimberly Williams, if she'll come up. Unlike the bishop, I have a baton here that I am passing on today. Y'all know, for those who may be saying, oh, there they go again, that's nepotism, because I know I heard it when Bishop brought me online to be the executive pastor and to be over finance, administration, payroll, I mean, all that stuff. And Bishop had to say, no, yeah, she's my wife, but if I can't trust my wife, who can I trust? Because I know she is never going to do anything intentionally to hurt the church because it hurts her. But beyond that, she has the academic and the corporate experience to be in the position that I was in. I hold degrees in accounting. I have a doctorate in leadership, in management. And I am a Virginia CPA. I worked in public accounting, and I worked in my own CPA practice for 15 years. I think I was qualified to be executive pastor. And my successor has a BS degree in accounting from the North Carolina Agricultural and Technical State Institute, A&T, University. She has her master's in accounting from Michigan State, and she has her doctorate degree in strategic leadership from Regent University. And come on, put your hands together, because just this year, she passed the Virginia CPA exam. She is a licensed CPA. She also has corporate America experience, having worked with the, I was gonna say Big Eight, that dates me, it's Big Four in there, isn't that right, Kiara? She's in that field as well. She also worked with Deloitte, y'all, in Charlotte before I wooed her back home. So she is ready, she is capable, she is prepared. I have intentionally been mentoring her for these last 12 months. So as I've said to some of you who sent me emails or made phone calls, and then Kimberly returned the phone call because I've been pushing everything to her, because I wanted to say to her, well, what do you think about this? What do you think? How would you do it? Because I am ready to pass the torch. I am ready to pass this baton. So effective January 1 of this year, or December 31 for me of this year, I am officially passing this baton. Please come up, Kimberly. That she will take the title of Executive Pastor of the Mount Global Fellowship of Churches. And I will be assistant to the bishop. So I'm not going all away. I will continue to assist the bishop in the office of the bishop, you know, with strategies and organizational structure and those kind of things that he may need assistance with, but everything else is her. And yeah, and I'll still, she say, and her. Now, if she needs me, she know I'm still here. I'm a phone call away, because we still want everything to be done right, but she's ready, y'all. She's ready. And so this baton says, Legacy 2022. Elder Valerie K. Brown to Dr. Kimberly Williams, CPA, the title of Executive Pastor of the Mount Global Fellowship of Churches. May God grant you the wisdom and discernment needed to lead his people.
Now, y'all know TMP, Chesapeake, you know my love for you is unwavering. TMP is so gangster, you know, because that's my hometown. And so last night when we shared with them, TMP said, Bishop, we praying for you. Don't worry about what anybody think. You just do what the Lord tells you. I mean, they just made, I felt like I heard rocking music last night when TMP finished. So on behalf of Elder and I, thank you all for how you serve. Now, what are we, sir, have allowed us to serve you? What are we taking out today, y'all? Let's get our story straight. Number one, Bishop ain't sick, ain't dying. Number two, Bishop's still the pastor of the Mount Chesapeake. Number three, Pastor LJ and Dr. Keisha are the succession plan for him and Elder at the Mount Chesapeake. Number four, Kimberly Williams, I told Linwood, come stand. Yeah, Linwood, come stand. This son-in-law thing, I'm getting used to it, boy. I'm getting used to it. I was a little out there at first. I wasn't really feeling this son-in-law stuff and all that. But I started feeling it a little better this week. Went to play golf. He walked in. He said, I got it, Pop. I said, yeah, you got it. Go ahead. Handle your business, man. Handle your business. You know, when they were dating, I wouldn't let him pull his credit card out. Now that he own her, I mean, I shouldn't say it like that. Now that she, because I know the women, like, he don't own her. She ain't no chapel. Chattel or whatever. Now that he's married, he pulled that credit card out. He was waiting for me to say, no, I got it. I just sat up there, riding 18, bro. Why you got your credit card out? Need some golf balls too. Go on, get some golf balls. Just playing, but I'm just really proud of them. So the last piece is that starting January the 1st, Elder will just be with me in the office of the bishop and Dr. Kimberly. Elbow your neighbor one more time before we do the benediction and just say, get it right, please. Now y'all know all the folk that belong to everybody else's church gonna start blowing y'all up before you get home. Just tell them that my cousin came in here today
and brought group therapy. And he was joking, and he was joking. Based upon my side of the Brown family, we could be cousins. I just thought I'd throw that out, you know. That we had a ball. I cannot tell you how today has ministered to Elder and I, ministered to our family. I love these young men and young ladies who stand over there and share the gospel. Just thank y'all, to staff, to everybody. We're gonna do this one time today. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, present us faultless before the throne of God. To the only almighty God be glory and majesty, dominion and power. Guess what? Based upon what's been ministered to us today, I declare, not only are you blessed, but you got a harvest in the field, you got a harvest in the city, you got a harvest when you come, and you got a harvest when you go, in Jesus' name.
Well, that was something else. That right there, well, I don't know if you had a good time, Peacock.
I had an amazing time.
I had a great time. And then we had a whole lot of stuff happen.
We had a party. We partied. We had a party.
Everybody kept their clothes on, though. That was good.
We was turning up. I thought we were going to get a word at all. Because we was turning up.
Anthony Brown did what he was doing. He said we were going to turn up.
Because that's Bishop Brown's cousin, right?
On his daddy's side. Yeah, it's like a third.
And he went to HSBC.
It's not a HSBCU.
You don't even know where to start with, because people just ask letters and then they make it their own. So.
No, it ain't. We had an amazing time Sunday, man. We had bombshell announcements made. So let me go ahead and make sure we get it straight.
Because Bishop said get it straight.
I am now the pastor of the Mount Portsmouth.
He did not say that. He did not say that. He said the Lord is going to tell him, and the Lord did not tell him that it was you.
The Lord said it was me.
The Lord is on vacation right now. He put you on hold when you asked for that.
No, Bishop right now has already said a succession plan in place.
Yes.
So before y'all go out and run and gossip and tell it wrong, Bishop is still the pastor of Mount Chesapeake. But when he decides that day has come, that he don't want to be the pastor no more, when y'all get on his last good nerve, he gonna go ahead and give it all over to LJ. So LJ,
and just be a granddad.
Yeah.
LJ gonna step up and take over the Mount Chesapeake.
So we wanna go ahead and congratulate him and everybody at Mount Portsmouth. That's exciting.
It was like a very proud moment to have been here in the building when LJ actually walked right through while we were working.
Okay, go ahead.
It was such a proud moment when he actually stood up, and I don't know if anybody else saw LJ, but I saw him from like the side view, and he stood up proud. It was that Simba moment where in Lion King, where they held him up like, LJ stood proud.
But we ain't finna kill Bishop off like they did Mufasa. We not gonna do that. We're not going to do that. And not only that, but Elder also announced her succession, and Dr. Kimberly Williams.
Dr. Kimberly Williams. Stepped up.
Because her husband worked hard for that last name.
So January 1st, Dr. Kimberly Williams, and she's taking over. So Elder said, don't text her, don't ask her, because she don't work here no more.
At the watch night, she don't work here no more.
She ain't going to make it to watch night. She said December 31st.
That's watch night. We gonna move on because she don't know her dates. She don't know what an HBCU is. It's amazing. We had a great service though, man. If you missed it, it was great. One of the things that I really enjoyed is that we had so many people back in person, man. So it was great to see all of the sites
represented. And we gave a lot of giveaways away. You gave some stuff away.
Man, I gave out tickets.
To the Gospel Fest
on the 24th. Yes. That's going to be amazing. Ty Tribbett. Lots of people going to be in there. I gave out Amazon gift cards.
Y'all gave out gift cards.
Man, we had great day. Only at the Mount.
Only at the Mount. We had all the sites here.
Even two people from Charlotte. Even two people showed up from Charlotte.
In one building. And we had a lot of people. We had VIP guests. Let me tell you something. If you missed this,
you can go to
our YouTube page.
Yeah, but it ain't going to be the same.
It's not. But you can turn your lights down.
You thought I was worth saying.
You can turn your lights down and then turn the volume up and act like you was right here. Because he did come in hard with that.
Yeah, he came in with it.
Is that his song?
That is.
Are you sure?
That's why he sang it.
There you go. Because sometimes people say something.
We going home, man. Okay. Waffle House is calling me. Listen, thank y'all so much for another. another amazing mountain experience. Again, before you go run, tell it wrong. Bishop is not retiring. He ain't sick. He ain't dying. He's just setting in place good stewardship, setting in place his succession plan.
Yes.
And congratulations to L.J. Brown, who'll be taking over, and Dr. Kimberly Williams.
The church is supposed also to do what? Here.
We're going
to
change draws.
We're going to change lives.
Lives.
Have
lives.
A great
My
day.
Fault. Y'all have a good one. Lives. I be forgetting.